go. Oh yeah, fantastic. We're getting started here, and welcome into the NightScaper Conference pre-event. Tonight I am joining you with a guest that you'll be seeing here in a few minutes. Our guest tonight is one of the speakers from the 2021 NightScaper Conference, Matt Dieterich, and it is going to be great to have him here with us. As you guys are just jumping into the live stream, make sure that you take a second to go and share it with your friends who are photographers. Let them know that we're going to have a free event right now. It's starting as I speak. We are doing this. We're going to learn some astrophotography in national parks tonight with Matt Dieterich. So let them know. Get on here. It's Sunday night. They might think it's tomorrow night. So let them know. It's Sunday night now. We're going to do Sunday night through the rest of April. And then I think in May, we'll have it on a Monday night. But we'll see what our producer, Royce Bear, says, the OG Nightscaper. So thanks, everyone, for hanging out in here. Oh, you're welcome, Alan. I'm happy to give you a plug, man. I love your work, and so I have to do it. I'm not a liar, and so I'd have to just spill out everything. If you guys hang on late, I'll tell you all my secrets. I usually end up doing that at the end of live streams. Kathy from Perth, Australia. Oh, Perth, man. And I'm watching the time lapses that are going through on the International Space Station. Sometimes you'll see a blank area that has lots of land and has this one big coastal city light bloom, and you're thinking, where could that be? And as I watched it, I thought, I bet that's Perth, Australia. I looked it up, and it was. I was so proud of myself for my geo-wizard knowledge that I could recognize that's probably Perth. I mean, of all places that has nothing around it but a lot of light pollution on this edge of a large landmass, that'd be Perth. So I'm glad you're here with us tonight, Kathy. Welcome in. So Mozem says, hey. Susan says, kittens. Oh, yeah, I guess my cats are popping up and around in the background. They're joining me for tonight's live stream. Sometimes they like to hang in the background, but tonight they're with me live. So without further ado, let me go ahead. Oh, and Matt, go ahead and stop sharing your screen so we can see your face here in a sec when I bring you in. I want to introduce our guest for tonight, Matt Dieterich. He is a man who loves national parks so much that he's been a national park, let's see, astronomy ranger, that's what it was. You're an astronomy ranger at national parks. He has been an artist in residence at national parks, and perhaps a little too late to be really famous, he won an award of something awesome in 2016, and this is a fantastic honor, but he won the chance to have his image featured on the Forever Stamp. And getting your Nightscape image featured on the Forever Stamp is kind of like saying I got it featured on the VHS tape, you know, VHS tape cover of the year. Not many people like myself are looking at stamps, but that is something that is an honor. I have never had anyone look at my image on a stamp, so I would be stoked to have it. So I'd love to have it myself. Let's bring in our guest, Matt Dieterich. Hey, Matt, welcome in.
Hey, Aaron, thanks, guys. Awesome to be here with y'all.
I rubbed you a little bit with having something like a stamp being where you got your image on, but what's the reality? Where did you see the stamp, and how much was the stamp to buy? Was it one of the cheaper ones or more expensive ones?
Yeah, I mean, I can't believe it's already been 5 years now coming up this June when that kind of came out, but it was one of 16 celebrating the National Park Centennial back in 2016. And oh, so awesome. It was the Forever Stamp collection for the national parks. So I guess they were what, 50 cents or whatever they were now, the Forever Stamps.
But I have no idea. The last time I bought a stamp, I can't even tell you. So then with Matt's work out there, you were an artist in residence, but it doesn't say where. Where were you an artist in residence?
That was at Craters of the Moon National Monument. So that was in Idaho of last year. And it just, man, it just fortuitously happened that, I mean, with COVID, I mean, we were so close to canceling that trip with the park rangers, but they still wanted to make it happen. And next thing you know, Comet Neowise started coming into the night sky.
Oh, you that were was there in July. We
did not plan that. I mean, I did not grab a comet and throw it up in the sky and said, here, go under dark skies and shoot this. But that's being there under dark skies. I've never experienced anything in my life and probably never will. But that was what was just amazing, being at that park to get, you know, 7, 8, 9 nights, clear nights in a row, shooting the comet. And memories. It's amazing.
I won't tell the whole story this time, but I once snuck onto a film set, a film crew that thought I belonged there. And they thought I belonged there so much when I was there in Twin Falls, Idaho with them, that they're like, okay, tomorrow meet us out at the Craters of the Moon. Here's the map for it. Be there at 4 a.m. I'm like, should I go? He's like, of course you should go. You should be there and don't be late, you idiot. And he hands me the paper like I'm some sort of like insubordinate who wasn't paying attention to his job. I'm like, I actually don't have a job with you guys, but I'll be there. Yes. And so, yeah, I love Craters of the Moon. I'll have to tell you that story sometime. But I wanted to comment
here. Oh, absolutely.
I need to bring in a comment from one of our guests. You guys are our guests who are watching with us tonight. Thor Olson said, I keep a sheet of those stamps because of that shot. So he knows your image, Matt.
Wow. Wow. That's hilarious.
Awesome. So tonight we're going to hang out with you talking about national parks. You're going to help us learn some astrophotography out there. I featured one of your images for the thumbnail for tonight's presentation. I was going to say lesson, but more of a presentation slash lesson where you have the NEOWISE shot in there. That one that I saw, was that your favorite NEOWISE shot?
There was a few of them, but I mean, like I said, the dry, as you remember, that Idaho, you know, high, I guess, plateau desert environment.
Yeah.
There's so little moisture that the comet, I mean, I remember, and I tell people the same with like the going to Chile about the Milky Way, but the comet literally took more than a hand, like a hand at arm's length to block out. Like that's how high the ion tail and everything above the horizon. It was spectacular how bright it was. So simple, quick exposures were so easy from dark skies. That's something we all can do, you know.
With the NEOWISE moment coming so suddenly, I didn't have a car that was working. I didn't have a camera that had a long enough lens to take advantage of it because I never used long lenses for my Astro. And so I was so ill-prepared for that. I was so glad for some friends on the Milky Way Photographers Guild who helped me out with some instant, like, here's $10, man, from me. Go get yourself a lens. And I'm like, oh, I love you. I love you. Thank you so much. And I got a few shots, but it was harder. You were up north a little bit more where you probably saw it more before sunset, but I really couldn't see it until sunrise, and it was just a little too bright. It was later the next week or after that I went.
Yeah.
It was during workshops that I actually could see the comet NEOWISE during nighttime leading into, you know, the darkest.
Yeah.
It's so much better when you had a dark sky with it. And the image that I just shared, I put the image up there on the screen so everyone can see it. You have a lot of detail in the splitting of the tails. It's fantastic.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's what that ion tail is, kind of that ionized jet that could be like that whitish blue, depending on the ions coming off. But it's always at that angle that, you know, not perpendicular with the sun, but it's just those ionized particles coming off the comet. And the rest is kind of, they joke, but it's true, a dirty snowball. You know, it's rock, debris, and everything that the sun is melting. That, I mean, that the distance of that tail, the icy debris tail, is just enormous. I mean, that's like fanning out through space like a tidal wave. I mean, it's amazing.
Oh yeah. And it's amazing how, where we see a lot of our comets, the one that I found, thanks to Alan Dyer's Twitter, I found one that was Comet Wirtanen. And Comet Wirtanen was just one of those green comets you see in the distance. You know it's a comet because it's a little bit of a green fuzzball. It's nothing more than that. But with this one that we just have with NEOWISE, unexpected, beautiful tail. We got to see all that detail. It was brilliant. What a great way to celebrate something in 2020, right?
Yeah. That was the shining light. This is the comet, you know.
Amen.
It's amazing.
So tonight in your presentation, you're talking astrophotography. You think you'll veer away any from the Milky Way core? I'm a Milky Way core elitist. What are you going to talk about tonight?
I mean, a lot of times it's just, as you mentioned there, I mean, I love the national parks. That kind of really got me into understanding how precious dark night skies are away from city lights and national parks. I mean, you'll find out in the presentation that to me and what I remember teaching when we were at Mount Rainier was, and I'm literally in Seattle, my buddies here in the hotel room were installing a telescope here. So like I got to see Mount Rainier today flying in, just spectacular. I mean, it's such a memorable place, but you know, you mentioned the stamp and all that, but in general, just national parks are islands of protected nature.
Awesome way to think of it.
The night skies in general, you know, that was the way I always appreciated them. And, you know, they're there for future generations. So we just have to take photos and get people stoked about getting out in the nature more, you know, to share it.
Absolutely, man. If there's nothing else that people know me for, it is, I say, get out there and have an adventure of your own. Like, just go. If your image turns out to be crap, if you have nothing, you have a flat tire, it's still memorable. You'll never regret the adventure that you take. So let's go ahead. I'm going to switch back to me and so that you can get your screen up and share over there for your presentation. So go ahead, Matt, and get that set up as we are talking. Everyone here who's joining me, a few more comments coming from Montufar Coldonier, Let's see, Sergio, Emilio, Montufar, Condonier. I hope I'm pronouncing that anywhere close, Sergio. But he says, cheers. We got a welcome back to the PNW, Matt, from Jan. And America's greatest idea is Mary Beth Kaczynski's comment. And we got a hello from warm and sunny San Diego. It feels a bit like San Diego here in Utah today. We have 70-plus degree temperature right now, and we'll be 70-plus tomorrow. But it'll go back to the 40s by Wednesday. So we got a little bit of a little flavor of summer. So looks like you're ready to go to get started on your presentation. Those of you who are hanging with me right now, we have 80 of us hanging out. Let's get some more in there. If you have any friends who'd like to learn about astrophotography in our national parks, learn from Matt Dieterich tonight, make sure you hit the share button on all the Facebook groups and just on your home page, just your page that you're watching from, just go ahead and say share with others and just get other people in here learning about Milky Way and just being grateful for the dark sky sights that we have in the national park. So with no further ado, let me turn Aaron King off and get hanging out with you, Matt. I'm just going to make sure that my picture does not show up over there when I flip to your side. And let's hang out and learn from Matt Dieterich. And here you go. Take it away, Matt. The time is yours.
Sounds great. Thanks again, Aaron. You bet. So, I mean, I appreciate everyone hanging out on the, you know, Easter Sunday holiday weekend, you know, to talk about dark skies. But I mean, let's just jump right into it. You know, we mentioned about that little trip to Idaho. This was one of the shots with my girlfriend Savannah that we were up atop one of it was Inferno Cone. It's kind of one of the centerpieces to Craters of the Moon National Monument. And you can get this cool vantage point by just going down the hill, the side of that ancient volcano, and you can aim the camera up to get a Milky Way shot with a silhouette. So I thought that was a cool, memorable experience with a girlfriend to get a single exposure. I mean, that was like a single 15-second exposure under those dark skies. Yeah, so it's just wild. But I mean, that was last year. And I mean, last year wasn't, you know, the first time that I, you know, jumped into the hobby, but nowadays astrophotography is so open to new creative, you know, artists and young people too, all around the planet. But, you know, each of us has a personal story and a personal connection to the night sky. And, you know, for me, you know, my journey into astrophotography, you know, started when I was a kid. And a lot of us, that's kind of where astronomy begins, whether it was an aunt or an uncle or a grandparent or a father or a mother taking us out under the night sky, camping or just stargazing in the backyard. You know, for me, it was, you know, when I was in elementary school and my godparents bought me basically one of these small, you know, department store telescopes that I thought what I needed to do was like just aim it through a window. Like I didn't even realize to take it outside and not view through a window, which is absolutely hilarious. But I was what, like 7 years old. So, you know, little $100 gifts can really change the lives of people. But, you know, I joke saying that a handful of years later in ninth grade, I remember that I got, or 10th grade, my parents got me this entry level telescope. And I always joke saying that false advertising got me into the hobby because on the box, you're not seeing, I mean, like on the box of this Mead, this is just a thumbnail, but it's like a nebula. It's like you can't see the color with the human eye. So I was curious as to how do I see Jupiter, you know, the size of a dinner plate, you know, and of course people were using cameras to take those images and I had no clue, but false advertising got me into astrophotography and I fell in love with it and it became just a lifelong passion. You know, it's the connection to the night sky that makes me feel whole. So in 2007, wow, it's a long time ago already, 15 years ago, already started this hobby almost, you know, it's amazing. But I wanted to show people what I was seeing. You know, I took an astronomy class that year in 2007 and I wanted to teach people kind of what I was seeing in the night sky and photography was a way to do that. So, you know, I finally got a camera. My parents helped me get that because that was back when the Rebel, the Canon EOS, you know, I think the European model, they call it the 350D. I mean, this is like the old school, the thing you can get online for probably like $50 right now. But back then it was like $1,000+ for this brand new camera that was revolutionizing the industry, you know, and I started out with film. It's crazy. So I never knew if any of my photos were in focus until, you know, weeks or days later when my mom took me to go get the film developed at a Ritz camera at the mall. And I remember always the guy laughing at me in kind of like feeling bad for me that everything was out of focus and there was just, you know, vignetting. There was no object. I had no clue what I was doing, but I loved the thrill of it. It was like the thrill of the hunt. But I finally started to kind of realize, okay, a digital camera is going to help, right? You know, because I could tell if it's in focus or not off the bat, you know, and did I even get a good exposure? So, you know, deep sky astrophotography was kind of my entry level point into the hobby. I didn't start shooting nightscapes until many years later, but this is a photo, my first deep sky successful photo from Cherry Springs State Park in Pennsylvania. It's a dark sky certified park with the International Dark Sky Association. So I remember laying there in the field. I had this little like piggyback refractor on my my telescope in the wide field image. I saw this and I stacked these photos and you see like the horrible field rotation and everything's all rotating around the center because my polar alignment was off. But I was so thrilled because that's a planetary nebula. I mean, that was a star that got old, expanded and gave off all this gas in the night sky there. I was thrilled. So, and of course you're underneath the Milky Way at that location as well. So it was just, a memorable experience to be out under a dark sky and capture something that you could share. And this is, you know, what's that, 12, 13 years later? I mean, it's just it's incredible looking back.
It's so impressive to see that in 2008, you're able to resolve that much. I know that it's nothing like a deep sky now, but it is something amazing for that in 2008.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I'll never forget. I mean, we look back at some of these memories, but, slowly over the few years of college and working an internship to like save up some money for the equipment, I started to realize, and this was another photo just taken from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, of the Bubble Nebula. And there's some hydrogen alpha emission that you see from emission nebulae. But I started to kind of get a recipe and see what I needed to kind of capture a worthwhile shot. And number one was dark skies. I mean, away from city lights. I mean, I know that makes so much sense to us now, but I had no clue what it took to actually take a real good photo of the night sky at that point. And, you know, taking long exposures in a lot of them, you know, like hours and hours of data, I started to see that, okay, if you stack about 3 hours of data, that will really start to look into a more publishable image, if you will. And I look back at this image now and I kind of scoff, but it's like back then I must have thought this was incredible because these are those photos from back in 2011, 10 years ago. And I started to kind of realize the recipe and just build on it. And
oh, that's awesome.
This one of the Orion Nebula is just another one example of that kind of recipe. It was like 3.5 hours of data. But you know, the Orion Nebula is just kind of in the belt, below the belt of Orion that a lot of us love shooting wide field, and stars are being born in there. It's a nebula. You know, gas is kind of combining and making new stars in the core there. So, that was with a 450D, you know, so still not that much newer of a, that was a Canon XSI, you know, so still very, very old camera.
I'm not
but
even
to me
familiar
at that point
with
time,
that camera. That's how old it is.
It's just a little crop sensor. It'd just be like a paperweight now. But I just sold that thing like 2 years ago anyway. Just hopefully someone else is going to make use of it. But
that is a really beautiful
and then
shot.
2012, like, yeah, I love this this one, Aaron. Was Spruce Knob, West Virginia, is just one of the dark sky spots on the East Coast. And one of our closest neighboring galaxies to us. And eventually the Andromeda galaxy is going to merge here with the Milky Way, which if only I could like fast forward and kind of see that. Can you imagine that? Like Milk Dromeda? Like I'm not going Milky Way chasing. I'm going like Milk Dromeda chasing where you have the Andromeda over here and Milky Way here. Like
it would be amazing. So it'd be scary and amazing as you see it coming closer. If you see those simulations you get on YouTube that shows how it comes up and hits and how it could look, it would fill the sky. Yeah. It could be amazing.
And this is a naked eye object, as in This galaxy is so bright that if you're at a relatively dark site, you know, just outside of a town, you can find this if you kind of invert your vision. You could see just a fuzzy smudge, and that's the Andromeda galaxy. But I'm kind of just going through the progression of, like, you know, 2011 to 12. And then this shot, I started to want to do more wide field stuff. And this was at Spruce Knob. I mean, this photo on the left, you can see like a tilted horizon. This was just this site. It was called the Mountain Institute in West Virginia there. And that's really close to Spruce Knob. And I met a great couple that goes camping every new moon. They take their truck and they go to the observatory there and they photograph the night sky. And I finally got to see them again for the first time in like 5 years, just a few this past fall. So they helped instill the human experience of about sharing the night sky, because that's a husband and wife that are in their, you know, mid to late 70s now, that have been doing this for decades. And they bond over that. I mean, to me, that's where I want my photography to go, is to just inspire people to experience the night sky. And you know, so these are just kind of my first wide field Milky Way shots. Again, you know, it's East Coast, so you have clouds come in random times of night. And but I was so stoked and proud of that one on the left, you know, for that in 2012.
Absolutely. I mean, when you get out there and you fall in love with the night sky because you saw a little teeny green dot, when you see something like this filling your entire frame, it hooks you.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. So that location, I mean, all of us can kind of relate to some location that we're just inspired, that where we kind of started our astrophotography from. And again, these are all, oh, wow. Yeah. These are all from Spruce Knob again. So the photos before, I was right behind this. This is an observatory that has a 16 inch Newtonian telescope. So you're kind of nestled in the Appalachian Mountains here, and there's light pollution around, but it's still one of the darkest spots on the East Coast. And that Milky Way, I'll never forget this night. There was a wicked lightning storm that came through, and I'm camping in my tent. Like, I'm not in like an RV or anything. I'm in the tent in this meadow, and they're like in their comfy diesel truck bed in camper next to me. And it just cleared, man. Like, Aaron, the sky just cleared, and it was the most transparent sky I've seen there, where, you know, they say, what, it was like diamonds on black velvet. I mean, and this is like East Coast. This isn't like the desert out west or like southern Utah, exactly. Man. So
not my spoiled every night sky. Yes, I know what you mean.
Yeah. Yep.
And that feeling when the clouds go away. I remember, I'm sorry to interrupt you too much there, but just that feeling when the clouds finally reveal the sky, it is like a curtain opening and the real show began. It's hard not to do anything but just stare for hours. I love that feeling.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. And I mean, they're just memories, man. It's, I remember I had, you know, I would set up the telescope, right? I mean, like, I was doing deep sky. I was using a telescope to take longer focal length shots. And I remember this photo in the top right of just that Milky Way, but I had the telescope set up. But, you know, I think this was like when I was finishing my master's in geology. And I was like, I was down there in November, freezing my butt off. And the next day I drove 5 hours to get back to a mineralogy lab in downtown Pittsburgh. And I wouldn't trade it for anything in the world, because it's like, I mean, the Milky Way, it's just a celebration of seeing something that we don't get to experience like we can, you know, decades ago, you could see the Milky Way from, you know, from people's homes. But now, I mean, light pollution is unfortunately getting worse, to the point that it's like, man, we got to travel far distances, most of us, to get to skies to see the Milky Way, you know?
Yeah. It's so sad that some people have never seen it and have no understanding of what it is.
Yeah. Yep. So that kind of preluded to that, this national park talk. And I know a lot of you are here for the discussion on the national parks. And that was just a little prelude of kind of my little quick journey into astrophotography. Cause then by 2015, I got done with grad school and I was so motivated to kind of do something for myself that wasn't school related, and to follow something that has been in my mind since I was a kid. And that was national parks and adventure and being in nature and dark skies. And all that culminated into this expedition that I called it, and I labeled all my photos out on my hard drive, because this was my first time going away from home and traveling to do something that I wanted to do. And, you know, I know all of us can kind of relate to something along those lines in our life. Mm-hmm. That was kind of this aha moment of like, wow, like if I just go do what I enjoy, I know that's difficult. And it's, to me, it caused so much anxiety. But it's funny looking back at all those experiences, just to go work at Mount Rainier National Park as an astronomy ranger. Like I said, I mean, I had so many little anxious moments, but it culminated into something that I met great people. I realized that you go out in the nature and you're going to meet people that are interested in similar things. And nature has this healing aspect to it that I really fell in love with, too. It's just peaceful. You can really let your thoughts just drift away. So, you know, I planned that road trip. I hit up some of these national parks on the way based on clear skies, you know, from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, all the way to Mount Rainier.
That's a sweet drive.
Badlands. Oh, man, it was beautiful. It was wild. You know, Yellowstone didn't clear up, though. It was cloudy that night, but Glacier was spectacular. Yeah. So, you know, this is just a map. I mean, I'm sure maybe a lot of you guys have seen these kind of light pollution maps before. So the very white areas are like pure downtown city lights. You can see like the moon and a few stars. That's it. But, you know, as I mentioned kind of beginning, I joke about it, but I mean, yeah, we do have national parks. You know, we have the Great Smoky Mountain National Park down here. That's on the East Coast. But once you start heading out west, I mean, you're opening yourself up to these islands of protected resources that are also protecting the night skies, because national parks are sacred land that's protected that you can't build on and, you know, make a factory and do that sort of thing. It's just protected wilderness. So they're islands of dark skies that are havens for astrophotography and just hiking and bird watching, anything, just relaxing, you know? So here's a shot. That was the first night at Badlands, and this was kind of the first time shooting and finally capturing airglow. And airglow is that green, you know, the photochemical reaction of that, the sun radiating on oxygen molecules in the atmosphere. And that radiation gets given back off that oxygen at night, and the camera can pick up this crazy green, depending on the altitude that those, oxygen molecules are radiating out that light. And, I mean, it's like false aurora is kind of what they call it, because it seems like it. It's pretty crazy. And then the clouds, but I thought that was a cool shot with a little boardwalk.
Oh, yeah, that's pretty really neat. Awesome. And it's amazing when your first time you see the air glow, you think, oh, is this aurora? What's happening? But you get to a dark enough sky and you can see that, you wake up to a whole world, a whole bevy of colors that are available. I think I might interject this question now. I was going to wait for the Q&A, but Dave says, does Mount Rainier still have an Astro Ranger? Do you know?
I'll have to double check. My buddy here that's hanging out with me for this telescope install in Seattle, he is one of the volunteers, but I know that one of the other couples, Tom and Gracie Polly, they used to come up like once a week. And I just need to double check. So maybe I can double check and get someone's contact info to relay that, Aaron. I mean, if I could message him afterwards.
You should be able to in Facebook. Just look at the replay. Everyone who's watching now and those who might come later, you can watch this replay anytime and you'll see the chat right there and you can find Dave Foreman's question and you can contact him directly. That'd be awesome.
Perfect. Yeah, no, Dave, I'll try to shoot you a message and find out, because I know last year with COVID stuff was put on hold, but I hope this year that they get that back, because I mean, now everyone's getting vaccinated and all that, but I can check on that. So, and bug me if you don't hear from me, but I will try to look into that.
Awesome. Thanks for taking a question mid presentation.
Sure. And then, so Badlands, I spent one night there. And then I kept going on Yellowstone that next night, or I did Devil's Tower the next night. That was cloudy. Yellowstone was cloudy. And then finally Glacier. We had like 4 or 5 nights in a row of clear skies. And myself, you know, being afraid I'm going to be eaten by a grizzly bear at every turn, or like a wolf here in Glacier, because I mean, nature is raw out there in Montana there. It's wild. So, but never saw any grizzlies. We did see a wolf, pretty sure. So that was kind of cool. But airglow again was just wild. And this is back when I was using that Nikon D750, and I started doing these panoramas. I don't know if you can like see me while I'm doing a presentation.
Yeah, we can see your
on
hands.
The webcam or anything, but
yep, I got you in the bottom corner.
Yeah.
They can see you.
So yeah, perfect. So like I motioned this motion right now because this panorama, it's like a mosaic. So like you use that 24 millimeter lens and aim it up and then overlap the next photo and take a photo to go down and do that to kind of get this wider field of view. And with panoramas, they're really cool because you could print them extremely, extremely huge and have amazing resolution to your photos. So panoramas are a fun technique that I teach on workshops and I love for folks to use because you can get this whole scale. You can overlay all these photos and get a wide field of view. And with the air glow and the Milky Way and still a little bit of the melting snow, you know, with this lake in the background and a little bit of the Milky Way reflecting is just spectacular. And this is just a road pull off, you know. You don't have to, you know, bushwhack 9 miles up a mountainside to soak in the night sky at a national park, you know. So Glacier is a fantastic one for those of you in the Pacific Northwest or anywhere that want to go to it. Now, let's see. So I guess we finally made it to Mount Rainier National Park finally. So, you know, we would set up and do star parties and teach astronomy. And once a week, like I mentioned, the Paulies, they're a husband wife teacher couple that will drive up once a week, and they would let us use some of their equipment, and they would help teach the star party. And I would set up their Takahashi refractor, and we would have, you know, 20, 30, 40, 50 people all hanging around taking Astro photos with us. And the coolest thing was like when kids, you know, when we were done editing the photo, we would airdrop it, you know, we would just Bluetooth it over to their phone. Next, you know, these kids are like taking their phones and putting like, you know, the background of the nebula or the galaxy we just shot on it. And one kid was getting yelled at by his mom because it was like 30 degrees out and he was sitting there with us editing, and his mom and them were like sitting there sipping hot cocoa in the van, but he was like glued to the computer. And those are the moments that it's like, you know, you want more people to get involved in this stuff. It's, you know, we didn't, I don't know. Those are the memories I miss the most, you know, the kids and the older people into astronomy for the first time, you know?
Yeah, that's gold. That's gold. That's awesome.
And let's see. So, I mean, we in the lodge up at the Paradise Inn, we did, I did a couple talks, you know, we did these evening ranger programs. And I mean, my goal was, I mean, at that point in time, my connection to Night Sky was so emotional. And I just wanted folks to be trying to feel that same calling that the Night Sky could do. And, you know, I know people were just visiting maybe for a few days, or they're coming from a busy life in Seattle just to get away. You know, we were there living for, you know, 4 months on a mountain. So everything was so slow. It was a super slow pace. And it was one of the more peaceful times in my life to try to like understand, to reflect and appreciate what nature can do for your well-being and the mental health and all that cool stuff that being out under the night sky can do for us. It's like live TV, but better. I mean, that's what I joke about, that it's just, you never know what you're going to see. Like, am I going to see a meteor come by, or am I going to see some satellites, or in some scenarios, you know, am I going to see like the Northern Lights? I mean, that was one of the coolest things that wow. At our latitude at Mount Rainier that summer, you know, we had a handful of events where we got to see the Northern Lights. So I wonder if this video will play, and maybe Aaron, you can let me know.
It's just fine. We're seeing it great. That time lapse is working perfectly. Oh, that's gorgeous too.
Sweet. Okay.
I want to see it again.
So maybe I'll play it again. So, I mean, look up here. You can watch the folks coming, you know, they would start summiting the mountain. This is probably 1 a.m. These are their headlights. You can see the little trail. If you could see my pointer at all, but
yeah, we can.
You know, you have the mist. It's just crazy. You know, that was one of the more emotional nights I've ever experienced underneath the night sky, you know, hands down. And I'm super stoked for my July workshop to kind of go back to the location with folks and share it with them, because, you know, I remember this was back, this was in 2015. And I remember like a few days before that, I remember this guy from Utah hiking, summiting Rainier and all that, but he unfortunately passed away because his tent blew away and he couldn't find it in the whiteout up near the summit. And it was just one of the more, I guess, emotional experiences I had of like, I pictured that kind of as just a symbolic thing of like the Northern Lights behind the mountain, you know, when this they just found the news about this, you know, young climber passing away from, you know, from the cold and all that sort of thing. It was just, to me, those are kind of the memories that kind of stick with me from that time lapse. And it's crazy to just look back and you never know what you're going to see in the night sky unless you get out there and go to these locations and just soak in, you know, the Milky Way, or in this spot, just a reflection lake. It's just crazy. So it was just a, I don't know, 100, 200 frame time lapse. You know, we saw the Northern Lights up by when we were working up at the star party that night. A gentleman from Germany was asking about how do I take a photo of the night sky there. And what we did was we just aimed his camera north up at the lodge, and I saw this kind of pink hue. And of course, when I saw that, I was like, oh crap, we got the Northern Lights going on. So after we got done working, and I went down there and just set up one camera and just let it shoot. And you know, lo and behold, this was a special night, because that was going back to my start of you know, shooting night sky stuff back with film, like when I was in high school in 2007. My teacher said, try to take star trails photo, because you don't need to track, because the earth is turning, so you could just make cool star trails. And I never captured and made a star trails photo, because I said, you know, that was boring, that's too easy. And I laugh now because I told her this, and I'm still in touch with her. That's Sue Batson, was my astronomy teacher in 10th grade. And I joked to her about that, because the first star trails photo I did with that data was this one with that time lapse. Because the time lapse was stationary, as in my tripod was standing there on the trail and it didn't move. So all those photos, you can overlay them, and you can make the night sky rotation show from the earth moving. And you can make that cool thing. And of course, with the Northern Lights going in the background, you can get that cool glow that, I mean, it's crazy. I mean, the pink in reflecting off Reflection Lake of all things. So I'm very humbled that I waited that long to finally make a star trails photo, because then later that summer, that's when they asked for photos of night sky stuff. And next thing you know, I had to be hush-hush, because they said, we want one to put on a stamp. And that's how that happened.
Forever stamp.
That's the forever stamp. Yeah, that's it. That's so gorgeous. John Jarvis is the bottom in Washington there. He's the he was the you know, the head honcho of the National Park Service. And meeting him, I remember pitching to him, but this was at one of the auction dinner things here in Seattle the next year in 2016, I was pitching him my idea, because back in when we learned about the parks, you know, one of the gentlemen back in the day was not liking how the parks were being ran. And basically the folks in Washington, D.C. back 100 years ago said, well, if you think you could do a better job, then you come do it. And, you know, I'm drawing a blank on that gentleman's name that said that, but that was kind of my pitch, to be like, okay, if I let him know that I want to come like teach all the national parks on like astrophotography and get folks involved, maybe he'll give me a job. Well, it didn't pan out that way, but, you know, knowing how important night skies are, and he could relate, you know, cause he, you know, he's worked in the Park Service for the majority of his life, but then, you know, the Postmaster General in the top right at the one presentation for the stamp fair. And, it was just a crazy fun year, to see how folks reacted to the night skies. And, we all can relate to them in one way or the other. I mean, that's my belief. So it's, I think that's one thing as human we can all relate to. So I'm definitely happy about that.
That's a terrific shot. And it's just something to show for, you have that forever, even though, okay, the name forever is on the stamp. I won't say that. You have that for the rest of your life to celebrate that moment, a moment that started with a little bit of kindness, a little bit of unselfishness saying, oh, he needs some help learning how to shoot towards the night sky. Let me show him how to get the settings. Oh my gosh, up here, there's aurora happening. And someone said in the comment that was a KP7 to 8 night. And so you were about to miss a KP7 to 8 night if you hadn't done that little act of kindness to share your information and knowledge with this guy, and then that led into becoming one of the stamps. Oh, it's beautiful. It's just a beautiful example of how we all need to be nice nightscapers and not the ones that are selfishly yelling at someone for showing up in the middle of your shot.
The ironic part is I remember on this trail that actually happened, you know, because someone was finishing climbing and was having their headlamp on. But it's like we all have had experiences like that where, you know, you're trying to get your shot. But I wish I could go back to those days. I don't want to say I was naive back then, but I just started using Instagram at that point in time. You know, social media to me at that point in time was so new. I would just post photos on my website. And I mean, this is getting more philosophical into kind of how we promote or market our work and that sort of thing. I kind of miss how naive I was back then, you know, because I want to get back to the days where I want the photography to be done to just inspire people. I don't want it to be something for my ego, because I feel like that for me, that could be just a toxic thing. You know what I mean? Because it's social media is so tricky to compare. I mean, it seems like a contest, and you know, for us, it's like, for me, the night sky is, it's a tricky conversation, you know, cause it's a great thing to promote, and share. And I guess in doses, I guess. Right. And, I know I can improve when it comes to that stuff too, you know, with utilizing it. But I'll never forget those years of Rainier, because I was like, what's Instagram? So I guess I'll post some stuff there. Like, there's all these new features to use, you know, social media's routes. So, but it's such a great location to share stuff, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. And speaking of social media, you'll have to explain the acronym, the Astronomy Photography Photo of the Day. What does it stand for?
Oh, yes. Yeah. So NASA, two professors like curate Astronomy Photo of the Day. So, or Astronomy Picture of the Day. And, you know, for me, you know, growing up as a kid, it's like, yeah, that was going on where one photo a day was recognized by NASA. And, you know, of course, I idolized a lot of the people that that were getting those photographs, and it gave you something to strive for and improve. I mean, that ever growing challenge to improve and grow in our photography, that was something with APOD that you can look up to mentors that way that I found. And when I shot the Perseid meteor shower over Mount Rainier that that same summer, you know, I submitted that. And And ironically, I mean, I should be I should be giving credit to David Kingham, who's also a nightscaper, that inspired me to get out into the national parks in general. And he's the one that inspired this shot, because he taught on one of his lessons, you know, online, how to stack meteor shower photos like this. So, I mean, I don't feel worthy. I mean, David is really the master that showed me how to do this. And I just went there and clicked a few buttons and worked in the editing. But passing on the knowledge is something that all of us can keep doing to inspire young people, because David did that for me, whether he knows that or not, with his van life and his trailer and all that stuff about traveling and shooting. That inspired me to go on this whole 2015 expedition, and it kind of culminated in the stamp and then this APOD that I'll never forget getting that email and crying. I mean, tearing up, because I mean, that's just something for 10 plus years that I kind of inspired, you know, was inspired by other photographers from those photos on APOD. And it was just like, wow, you know, you take chances and go away from home and kind of follow something that you care about, and the universe kind of conspires in a good way. You know what I mean? And it's such a philosophical year. I mean, that summer, it was just weird. It really was. It was, you know,
and that's when he started growing his beard.
Actually, 100% was. It 100% was. Royce joked about that. I started growing it, and then he joked, Matt, like, Matt, your beard's kind of gotten longer, when I talked to him on the phone on Friday. So it's been 6 years. So, but, I mean, yeah, it's crazy, Aaron.
These are two awesome shots. I love the one on the right is something I've always wanted to do. I've never done. Tell us more.
Yeah. And I mean, so fast forward a few years, I mean, I would try to visit national parks, but one of the rangers I worked with at Mount Rainier, he became a ranger at Craters of the Moon. And we wanted to do this national park artist in residency for a while. And finally he bugged me enough that last year it worked out with the scheduling. And you know, the photo on the right is, people kept saying it was like a gecko's eye. And when I looked at it, when I posted on Reddit or wherever, I'm like, holy crap, that's so true. I didn't even think about that. Like this abstract view that people can see. And for me, I see this, I look at it from like this scientific aspect of like, you know, you got light pollution, you have air glow. I mean, you have these like gravitational waves with the green on the right-hand side, and then the Milky Way just cutting through. But to do that shot, I mean, you just need a 14 millimeter lens. You could do it with a little bit more magnified. You just need to take more photos. But that was like 36 photos. So you just overlap them enough. Just shoot tons and tons of photos and shoot the ground as well. Aim the camera all around the ground. And you can do that kind of fisheye, the fisheye projection in editing, and create that all sky look. Because to me, that's like wild. I mean, seeing the light pollution, the impact that has on the night sky. That's and then the green air glow. I mean, the air glows is wild. You know, it's crazy.
That is such a cool shot.
And then, that was up atop. My girlfriend's probably not watching this. She's probably busy with stuff. But I give her mad credit for this, Savannah. So if she's watching, she was a trooper for that whole entire trip. So I mean, she's not a photographer, but she is an artist. She's an incredible painter. But she toughed it out. Man, Aaron, she is literally over here sleeping on volcanic rock underneath the night sky while I was shooting this. That's her, that little speck. I was going to have my buddy edit a vlog just of like, and I totally forgot to shoot this stuff, of like just funny B-roll of where is Savannah sleeping, because she'd be sleeping on volcanic rock. One time she was sleeping in the bed of the truck. She was sleeping in the cab of the truck one night. She would stay up late and just let me. So, I found a keeper for that respect.
Yeah, because, that is support.
I mean, we've been up till 3 a.m. Yeah.
Yeah, and you're up that late, and it's usually cold.
I love her to death.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So
Matt, props to her.
I appreciate her. I know. And so culminating in that, yeah, she was a trooper for that whole trip. And then the Neo Wise shot on the left, that was the strongest bands of air glow that I've ever seen. It just, I don't know, different environmental conditions makes it pop a little bit better. And that was when Neo Wise was just, it was hugging, man. It would just hug and kind of rotate the mountainside there. And that was spectacular to just shoot it, you know, for that shot there. Yep.
Better than any of my shots. I love it.
So you can play with more panoramas, you know, going back to that trip in 2015, you can then go even full, you know, fully overboard. And I mean, my editing style kind of now, I try to be a little bit more gentle and just more natural. But I mean, we ebb and flow as artists, I think. So this one was a 77 panel mosaic that I did with a 50 millimeter lens, and you can see, you know, obviously the Milky Way arcing, all this red is emission nebulae in the night sky, and Jupiter, Saturn, Andromeda galaxy over here, you know, the double cluster in Perseus. It's just, it's pretty spectacular. And then of course the light pollution, and then this in the background was Inferno Cone. That was that big kind of main volcanic feature at Craters of the Moon. But all these little spatter cones, these little volcanic formations were just beautiful. So that, I love this one a lot. It's just a cool little wide angle shot.
One thing I love after doing this for 5 years now is it's really interesting to see that you can recognize a photo's year instantly by seeing where Jupiter and Saturn and Mars are. And here I can know, that came from last year.
Yeah. Oh, actually, yeah. I wonder. Yeah, because Mars started coming in too. I forgot about that. Yeah,
it did. Yep. Yeah, and that's going to be more featured this year as Jupiter and Saturn kind of take off and disappear. I think it's late in the summer we start to see them again in our shots. So.
Oh, cool. Okay. Look forward to it.
Awesome.
So we did these other shots. Yeah.
Let me know when you're ready for going into some Q&A questions, because I have a bunch piling up that I can go into. So
give me the word. Let's do it because we're almost near the end.
Yeah you want to go for it? Because these shots are good ones to keep up right now. So let's go to one that's recent.
Yeah.
Maybe you can find the answer fast. Mary Beth's wondering what day that comet shot was done a couple frames ago, a couple slides ago. Basically, she was out and doing same nights of doing the same kind of NEO-I shots. And she had one with wild air glow. And she's curious if you know the night of that to see if it times out the same time. She had great air glow.
Well, I mean, it was in July, and I had to see what week we were there, but it was like the second week of July. And I'm just going to go back in the calendar right quick to see, because we were there for 9 days, and it would have been between The 15th to 25th, so sometime in that time frame. And this was one of the first nights we were there, so I think maybe the 17th or 18th of July.
So then, Mary Beth, you can see if that matches up with your 17th and 18th. So let me go ahead and pull up another question. The question comes from, that's a question that Greg's been getting answered from Mary Beth. And Jan asks, a print of your forever image, how much did that sell for on the auction?
Oh, geez. Yeah, I forgot about that. That one, it was in a bidding war between this lovely lady and the former... the REI CEO at that dinner, and they were going back and forth, and that one went for 10K. I mean, this was all donated. Like, this was all to the national parks. Like, they, whether you need to fix trails, you know, buildings, Washington's National Park Fund. If any of you are big into Washington State National Parks, that National Park Fund helps, you know, do Olympic National Park, North Cascades National Park, and Mount Rainier. I mean, so that money went to those parks to try to help whatever their kind of annual goal was for renovations and, you know, keeping the park going. But that, I couldn't believe it, but yeah, I went for 10K. That was, a spectacular moment for the national parks for that. And I just donated for them. They had a bidding war and I died laughing. It was amazing.
That's terrific. Yeah. Nothing of mine has ever been worth that much. So while I tease you for putting it on a stamp of all things, the fact that you get that is an amazing honor.
Yeah.
So here's a question from Thor that I'm going to modify just a little bit, because you don't have to necessarily figure out or reveal exactly where you were in Glacier. So let me just ask you this. I mean, if you were to go to Glacier National Park and recommend two rough areas that people should go, what would you say to someone?
So a lot of times I'm trying to remember, I remember outside the park, there's like the town of Browning. So I think I was on the east side of the park. So Two Medicine Lake, I do remember that one. Two Medicine Lake was one of the areas where I would go down and shoot. So whatever side that Glacier, you know, the Two Medicine Lake is on, that area, because this was in May, this shot was in, middle of May. So that is a good time to kind of get it facing the mountains and that sort of thing, and some of the waterways that are in the park. So I think I was on the east side. I'd have to look at the map, but all I know is Two Medicine Lake. If whatever side that Two Medicine Lake is on, you'll have some awesome spots for Milky Way. And of course, scouting. I mean, Aaron, you probably teach the heck out of that in your workshops of planning and scouting in the daytime. That's what makes astrophotography fun, because then you can go to the scene and you could plan, you know, with photo pills during the daytime and see the Milky Way. Okay, at 2 a.m, it's going to be here. So you could sleep until midnight and then wake up and go shoot. You know, those are great things for planning your photography of up at Glacier.
Awesome. And here's another question that I'll modify as well, just because Greg got a good answer from Mary Beth. She was helping him out with his Sony camera. So I'll ask this question without any of my own personal biases. What do you do to get your favorite, or what's your favorite method to get sharp focus when you're doing Astro?
Yeah. So, I mean, when I was just down in Chile a few weeks ago, I finally picked up a Sony A7S III. And the reason I say this right now is because I found focusing with a Sony on live view, I mean, it was quick and easy, but these lenses now, you know, you can't just twist it to like infinity focus, because every lens, it might say infinity focus on the lens focus mark, but a lot of times it's actually not calibrated the right way. So during the daytime, I will focus my lens and on something super far away, you know, like a telephone pole that is the furthest thing I could see. And I will make a mark with like a little pen on my lens, not on the glass, but on if a portion rotates for your focus ring and then a portion that doesn't. So then all you have to do is you have your headlamp at night. You just turn your headlamp on, go right to that mark and you're done. Like you don't even have to worry about live view. But live view is the other way to focus at night. And you just zoom in on live view and try to get that tight focus. But during the daytime, a little less pressure, you know, because you're not wasting time underneath the night sky, and you can mark the lens and then it'll be at your true infinity focus mark.
Awesome. Fantastic. Here's a quick comment from Royce Bear as he came in. He's watching from us from his home. He says, was it the month of July 2020 that you're an artist in residence at Craters of the Moon?
Yes, it was. Yeah, so that was July. So I was there. We were there for 10 days about, so last July.
Awesome, fantastic. I wanted to confirm that. I believe that's what you had said during the presentation, but I wanted to make sure that was totally clear. So speaking of craters of the moon, a question from Veronica. She's wondering if it's easy to stay all night at craters of the moon, or do you need special permission?
Oh, and Aaron, this goes, I mean, you've been to a lot of national parks, right, as well?
Yes,
So,
yeah.
in general, you kind of know that. I mean, the joke from what Tyler Nordgren and all that stuff is half the park is after dark, right? I think.
Yep,
Am I saying that right?
half the park is after dark.
You don't get kicked out. I love it. You know, it's they don't kick you out. And I mean, a lot of times, I mean, you might run across like the busier national parks like Yellowstone or stuff like that. You might run into some law enforcement rangers that might kind of ask you what you're doing, but then just you show them on your phone, hey, I'm an astrophotographer. Here's my this is what I do. Because we had that happen to us when we were there just that one night. Because but no, the parks are open. I mean, like you can go in, you can shoot all night. A lot of times you just you if you can't car camp, unless you have, you know, unless you have your campground and that sort of stuff, because National Park Rangers, I mean, if people were allowed to just sleep in their cars, then all the parking spots will be full and people would do that.
Oh
So
yeah, exactly.
that's kind of the only thing that you know, but other than that, no, you can shoot all night. I mean, we had no problem. All national parks in general, that's why they're here for the public, for us. So you can go there and enjoy them all night. I just know that we only got you know, met up with law enforcement rangers in Yellowstone because they're there to keep everyone safe. That's what their duty is, and just seeing what we were doing in the geothermal, you know, areas. So, yeah.
So the next question comes from Ken, and he's asking a question that I'm curious about as well. How did you stitch your 70 images together?
Yeah. So surprisingly,
If you said Lightroom,
it
it
went
would be
pretty smoothly.
surprising.
And now the It wasn't Lightroom. I used, ironically, there's free software for Windows. I don't think it's on on Mac, but Microsoft ICE, Image Composite Editor. I have had the darndest of best luck with that software, and it's free. If Photoshop won't stitch something, which a lot of times Photoshop messes it up, you could use Microsoft ICE, and you could also try AutoPanagiga. I think that one is. I think they just kind of stopped making that, but the other one, PT GUI, PT GUI is another good one for panoramas, that work. But I used Microsoft ICE for this one, and I mean it stitched flawlessly. I mean I'm glad some of them stitched just easy. You kind of really have to get high up above Vega, like this star way up at the top. As long as you shoot ample frames high enough. Then the Milky Way, because you don't just want to stop the panorama like up here, because then you'll get the Milky Way like super distorted. But either way, it's distorted because it's shot to keep the horizon level, right? The Milky Way doesn't arc
Right.
like that in real life. It's a more of a straight line.
And then going on that question, thinking about national parks and getting your shots at night and whether or not you can stay there, Royce is asking, what's your favorite three national parks for Astro?
Geez. I mean, Mount Rainier is just so special. I mean, that's in my heart. I literally have a tattoo of it on my chest. It means that much to me. So, I mean, I love the diversity in the national parks in general. So, I mean, Arches was beautiful. Zion was beautiful. But I mean, Mount Rainier is one of my favorites. Glacier, because I just had a lot of time there, and I love going for water reflections. And Mount Rainier has some cool ponds and lakes that you can do reflections at. So, I love still bodies of water to get like Milky Way reflections,
Yeah.
and Rainier has a lot of spots. So that's definitely probably my number one. But of course, in summertime, that's usually when the Pacific Northwest has the most clear skies, so that's kind of helpful. But then Glacier, and then Glacier is extremely dark. I mean, like hand in front of your face, very difficult to see, especially like when you're in those valleys with the mountains. It
Oh.
it's blocking out more of that light pollution. You know, it's crazy. And then Craters of the Moon was dark. I mean, that was I think that those would be the top three for now, I think.
Fantastic. So before I go into this next question, because I want to take the screen and show you more large again, before we do that, I wanted to make sure if there's any other images you wanted to share from your presentation, that we get to see them now before we transition to showing you full screen. I just didn't want to miss out on anything awesome.
No, I think that is it. I mean, the one on the right is just a mosaic, but I had some issues with my modified Nikon Z6, where I was getting like what appeared to be like sensor tilt. So you see down here, like the stars are like tiny, but up here they're like bloated. So that's, and up here too, you see this side. This is going into technical stuff of like, once you have cameras modified and working with them, they need to be done the right way. Cause if your sensor is tilted, then some of the stars will be in focus and some will be out of focus. So there's pros and cons to get all that stuff done the right way and go to the right people. So yeah, but that's what I noticed in those photos when editing. But that's it for now. That's Savannah and me up atop Inferno Cone with Comet Neowise again. And then the last photos after this man will be like the Chile telescope install, plane wave suite stuff. So
Sweet. So then I can keep you probably on. We'll come back to your screen. So go ahead and stop sharing your screen just for a moment. And we'll just celebrate you and I right now as we talk about this stuff. You know, in fact, I am going to bring on my shoulder angel. Let's do shoulder angel with Aaron, just because that screen that you're showing of me down there shows me a little bit modified, a little bit funny. But here's the question. And the question is something that I know that I struggle with this just because my imagination is so dang vibrant. How do you deal, or what do you do to keep yourself, you know, keep your wits at night and deal with predators?
Yeah. I mean, I think going back like 2015, I mean, after grad school, it's like I was dealing with anxiety and all that stuff and like panic attacks. And then finally working at the national park, I remember having like a terror. I was hiking up, doing stuff in my rainier by myself, carrying like 50 pounds of gear by myself, going up, past up Tipsy Lake up, Notches Loop Trail by myself. And you'd see these big elk tracks. I mean, elk aren't going to do anything to you, but I mean, there's bear, mountain lions. And I just remember having the most terrible panic attack on the way down. Like I had to calm myself down because I was worried. But looking back on that experience, you're going to have times where you're pushing your comfort zone by yourself at night. And I think a lot of us can relate to that. If you start feeling uncomfortable, I mean, don't push yourself to where it's extremely dangerous, no matter what. Always tell people where you're going, what time you expect to be back. I had a national park radio with me. So in case I broke my leg, I could be like, hey, I broke my leg. I'm on the Natchez Loop. Come get me. So, I mean, have those backup plans, but, I had bear mace with me at Rainier. And a lot of national parks, I mean, you're not allowed to discharge firearms, but a lot of them you're allowed to carry firearms in case you need to. So I'm not saying utilize that, but I may or may not have carried a pistol with me in case I needed to for emergency situations, but I never had to. Bear mace would have been way more effective anyway, because it spreads out. I mean, that's the safer thing to do in case, sometimes just loud noises with guns are necessary, but that's extreme, like life or death stuff. But I never, ever had any of that stuff happen. It's all you need is bear mace, and kind of let the predators know that you're there in terms of making noise. It helps, but, kind of now I don't want to say I don't care, but, I feel like now I'm more comfortable with being out at night by myself, but being with someone, go out with someone else and, kind of ease yourself into it as a practice, and, realize that, if you kind of holler or say something like, hey bear, or that sort of stuff, I did that a lot at Rainier because there were bear, but, there was freaky moments like that. But as long as you kind of make yourself aware that they're there, then it's fine.
I can imagine they're freaky. I freak myself out when a rabbit goes by. I'm like, that sounds like a bear. It's going to eat me. And it was a rabbit. Veronica points out that an Astro buddy is really important. And she says her Astro buddy is 120-pound Great Pyrenees. He sees and hears things I would never be able to. Good Astro buddy.
Wow. No, that's perfect. Perfect hiking buddy. Absolutely.
Absolutely. Well, let's go ahead and get into our final question and final word from our man, Royce Bear. Let's get into this.
Hello, Aaron. Hi, Matt. So good to be here with everyone tonight, although I'm actually recording this on Saturday. In a minute, I'm going to ask Matt one last question, so don't go away. I say that because naturally I'm here to remind everyone of the NightScaper Conference, which is now only 5 weeks away on May 10th through 12th. This is a hybrid conference with 150 safely attending in person and hundreds more attending virtually. We have over 40 speakers from 10 different nations giving over 40 programs and panel discussions. Over 25 of those speakers will be at the Kanab Center in Utah to personally make their presentations in front of a live audience and answer questions. So you'll get to feel all the synergy of people coming together in those live broadcasts. All of this is going to be recorded and archived into the cloud, where you'll get to refer and replay it for up to a year. Virtual tickets are available at nightscaper.com. That's www.nightscaper.com, or you can go to roycebear.com. Matt, I actually got to look at a PowerPoint a few days ago of this pre-event webinar that you gave tonight, which is, by the way, only a portion of what you're going to be giving at the conference. And you talked tonight a little bit about what got you into astronomy and your love of nightscapes in the national parks. One last question I'd like to ask you tonight is about your day job with plane wave instruments. Now, plane wave makes telescopes and mounts for the astronomy industry, and I think you're the technical service manager for them, and you help lead their field instruments, installations, I mean. I believe you just returned from doing a couple of installations in South America. Tell us a little bit about that and some of your other more interesting installations.
So then going back into Royce's question, Matt, I'm just going to remind you real quick of it. He's asking about your technical service manager experience working with PlaneWave. And he says he just believes you just returned from doing a couple installations. And he just wants to know a little bit more about some of your more interesting installations that you had to do.
Yeah, absolutely. I can easily share the screen again.
Please do. Let's do it. That way we can see it as we go. Right. Please do.
Okay. Yeah. So, I mean, for those of you that don't know, I mean, I mentioned about this in my latest YouTube video, but my day job is working for PlaneWave Instruments, and we manufacture just awesome telescopes and mounts for astrophotography and other cool aerospace applications. But, you know, we just went down to Chile and worked on, I did three installs there at Obstech. So this is in the southern portion of the Atacama Desert. We installed these are two PlaneWave CDK 600 packages. So they're 24 inch diameter mirrors inside these telescopes. And then this big boy is the 1 meter. So inside there is a 1 meter mirror that is collecting light of the night sky. So just some test shots from that 1 meter. This is the Sombrero Galaxy, just single 2 minute photographs of a massive, massive galaxy. That's obviously not in our Milky Way. This is outside our Milky Way. This is another galaxy. So the astrophotography end of working for PlaneWave is just incredible. And this is another test shot of the, this is the Centaurus A galaxy. So it's just another stunningly beautiful galaxy. And for those of you that may not know, Chile is just the home to some of the largest telescopes on Earth, and is just an astronomy heaven. It has beautiful dark skies. So if you get to a chance to go down there, I mean, definitely add Chile to the bucket list. But we'll be doing workshops down to Chile too. So definitely stay tuned for those trips too. This is just a shot of me working on the telescope underneath the southern Milky Way there, which is just wild, because it's for us, it's upside down, but for them, it's right side up. So right. It's just beautiful down there. But yeah, just a drone shot. We installed these three systems in that roll-off roof observatory, and I can control it all from here on the internet, and take photographs of the universe and share cool stuff. So that's my day job. That's my passion. That's my love. And it's kind of fun to be able to tie that in and take cool photos at the same time while on these work trips.
If you could quantify a package that you could do yourself for your own backyard, what would it cost you?
Oh, geez. Like, I mean, we have people that put the 1 meters in their backyard. We have guys that do that. And that's $500,000 for the 1 meter. So it's just scary because it just collects so much light. I mean, it's a 6,000 millimeter focal length system. That's the comparable. That's what it is, you know, in terms of how much it magnifies those objects. So, but, you know, a small system fully set up, it could be remote and operational, like just the mount telescope, you know, it's like $25,000-$30,000. But you know, it's pretty maintenance free. You just let it run and capture images of the night sky and edit them. And the performance is just unreal. I've known of Planewave for a decade, and it's just been a joy to work for them for 3 years now already. So it's a treat. Yeah.
That's really awesome. And it's best probably said the way Mary Beth put it. She says, what a cool day job. Kind of brings this all full circle. You started the journey as a kid from where you did with that image in 2008 to now working for Planewave and doing what, half a million dollar installs. Wow. I mean, for those of us who are anxious to travel internationally, Chile, New Zealand, we have someone from New Zealand here with us right now. We're so jealous. Everyone in the chat has been saying how jealous they are of him from being in New Zealand. Now, where you have been out to the Atacama Desert, I mean, any recommendations of where we definitely can't miss when we go down there?
Oh, I mean, so this observatory, Obstec, I mean, it's a cool spot to visit. And eventually, I mean, they're going to be putting up a little cabana or whatever, if you will, so we can host workshops there. And I can't wait for that to happen. But the other place I really love in Chile is San Pedro de Atacama. It's in northern Chile. It's legit in the Atacama Desert. You know, you're at like 8,000 feet elevation, and it feels like you're in like a seabed. So it feels like you're at sea level, but you're literally at 8,000 feet because the volcanoes are at like 15, 16, 17,000 feet, like around the rim.
Wow.
It's, you know, we'll do workshops there. And I mean, it's just one of the most spectacular places to see the night sky. There's lagoons to go shoot, just the most dry desert air, good food, good drinks in San Pedro. So it's a cool spot to like take your partner or your significant other with you, because there's stuff for them to do. And just best night skies I've ever seen were in San Pedro.
Right on. Awesome. I mean, you mentioned your workshops a couple times. Before we go and end this live stream right now, we've had a lot of thank yous from those of them who are taking off or about ready to go. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thanks, Matt. Love this, blah, blah, blah. Love these presentations. A lot of props to you. Thanks so much, Matt, for coming here tonight. Is there a workshop available over the next several months that's open right now that we can pump right now and get some people to come fill up the slots?
The Mount Rainier one has sold out, but there's awesome. Going to be ones available. So I'm stoked about that for all the folks that have supported the Mount Rainier one for this July. But I mean, stay tuned on the website because I got ones listed there for next year. And now with travel opening back up, I mean, next year, I really hope that we'll do the Chile one. So if you guys have bucket list dreams to go to Chile, you know, we'll be leading workshops there. And of course, I'll do another Mount Rainier one next year. And I think I have those all on my website. Like 2022 workshops are already up.
Remind us of your website again. Show us the link for it so we can go there and everyone can bookmark it and check back in later.
We'll go back to the beginning. It's just www.mattdieterich.com. And you'll find most of the workshops there, you know, for next year. I got one in Utah with a buddy and in Kanab. I got the Mount Rainier one for next year, and we'll be setting up the ones in Chile too. So, and of course, private ones are always available. If you need a guide to take you to Chile and you know, host you and go through that stuff, let us know, because we could set that up and go down and do some cool astrophotography.
That's awesome. Fantastic. Go ahead and kill your share one last time so we can see you in full screen, full glory. I'm going to go ahead and make this a gallery view for both of us. Hey, thank you so much again, Matt, for hanging with me and doing this today. What a fantastic opportunity to hang with you, get to know you more. I make fun of stamps, but I don't make fun of that image. That image is glorious. I know why it went for the price that it did, and what an awesome experience for you to have them actually fight over it to be a part of it. So, Matt, thank you from everybody. Yeah. Thank you from those who are coming through. Mozam, Alan, Mary Beth, Fred, Donna, a bunch of thank yous just piled on right now. Really appreciative of your time with us tonight. And we want to thank everyone else who's joined us. Thank you for hanging out. This is number 4 of our Nightscaper pre-events. We will be back again next week. And the announcement will be on Royce Bear's Facebook page. Or you can follow him on Instagram. Or you can go to the nightscaper.com website. Actually, I don't think Royce is putting information in there. Follow Royce Bear's Instagram or his Facebook to find information on this. Yeah. And if you're not already in his mailing list, make sure you go and do that. So thank you, everyone. Great presentation. Royce says great presentation. Thank you so much, Matt. And we're stoked to have you tonight. Yep. And guys, get out there. Think about the ways that you can make the most of your night sky. Get out into nature. Yeah. And don't forget to stay out past dark at every national park that you go to. At least one night. Do it. Yeah. Absolutely. So, Matt, thanks again. Have a good night, everybody. And we will see you guys who can make it. All of those of you who can make it or virtually make it, we'll talk to you again in May just about a month away. So thanks to everybody, and have a good night. See you later.
Thanks, guys.
And I am